name of the Lord.
The maker of heaven and earth.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let us pray. Almighty God, you have called us to serve you, yet without your grace we are unable to please you. Mercifully grant that your Holy Spirit may in all things direct and rule our hearts. Through Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you and the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Let us humbly confess our sins in the presence of God and neighbor. Eternal God, in whom we live and move and have our being, whose face is hidden from us by our sins, and whose mercy we forget in the blindness of our hearts, cleanse us from all our offenses, and deliver us from proud thoughts and vain desires, that with reverent and humble hearts we may draw near to you, confessing our faults, confiding in your grace, and finding in you our refuge and strength, through Jesus Christ, your Son. Almighty Father, hear our prayer and bless all souls that wait before thee. Amen. If, while we were enemies, we were reconciled to God through the death of God's Son, much more surely, having been reconciled, will we be saved by his life. But more than that, we even boast in God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have now received reconciliation. Be always with you.
And also with you.
A cordial welcome to worship here at Grace Presbyterian Church, Bartlett, Tennessee. We're a congregation of the Presbyterian Church USA. We're glad you found us, whether you're among our members, our regular worshipers, or if you've found your way to us on the internet some way or other, welcome. It's good to know that you are there. We remember on Wednesday morning, we have a virtual morning prayer through Zoom. That Morning prayer begins at 9:30. We usually open the doors about 9:10 to catch up with each other. If you're not already part of that group and would like to be, just send me an email. You'll find my email address on the back of the bulletin and a couple of times in the bulletin insert. So we'd love for you to be a part of that. Also, about this time of year, in previous years, we've had a large celebration of Presbyterian Women Birthday and Birthday Offering. So check the insert, or maybe a special insert really this week, that will give you some information about the mission projects that the Presbyterian Women Birthday Offering is supporting this year. We encourage you to be supportive of that here through the month of June. And also, there'll be some information about how to get the study booklet for the Presbyterian Women's Studies that will begin in the fall, though there are some training and acquaintance sessions going on here in the summer. So look for that, and that will tell you how to get your PW study book and also remember the Presbyterian Women's Birthday Offering. We think at this point in the service of our children, we miss seeing you. We hope now that school is over, you're having a good first few days of summer. We look forward to seeing you very soon. We will, for now, remember you with our ringing offering.
Almighty God, in you are hidden all the treasures of wisdom and knowledge. Open our eyes that we may see the wonders of your word, and give us grace that we may clearly understand and freely choose the way of your wisdom. Through Christ our Lord. Amen. The Old Testament lesson today is Genesis 18, 1 through 15. The Lord appeared to Abraham by the oaks of Mamre as he sat at the entrance of his tent in the heat of the day. He looked up and saw three men standing near him. When he saw them, he ran from the tent entrance to meet them and bowed down to the ground. He said, "My Lord, if I find favor with you, do not pass by your servant. Let a little water be brought and wash your feet, and rest yourselves under the tree. Let me bring a little bread that you may refresh yourselves, and after that you may pass on, since you have come to your servant." So they said, "Do as you have said." And Abraham hastened into the tent to Sarah and said, "Make ready quickly 3 measures of choice flour, knead it, and make cakes." Abraham ran to the herd and took a calf, tender and good, and gave it to the servant who hastened to prepare it. Then he took curds and milk and the calf that he had prepared and set it all before them, and he stood by them under the tree while they ate. They said to him, "Where is your wife Sarah?" And he said, "There in the tent." Then one said, "I will surely return to you in due season, and your wife Sarah shall have a son." And Sarah was listening at the tent entrance behind him. Now Abraham and Sarah were old, advanced in age. It had ceased to be with Sarah after the manner of women. So Sarah laughed to herself, saying, "After I have grown old and my husband is old, shall I have pleasure?" The Lord said to Abraham, "Why did Sarah laugh and say, 'Shall I indeed bear a child now that I am old?' Is anything too wonderful for the Lord? At the set time, I will return to you in due season, and Sarah shall have a son." But Sarah denied, saying, "I did not laugh," for she was afraid. He said, "Oh yes, you did laugh." Join me in the reading of the verses from Psalm 116 as printed in the bulletin. I love the Lord because he has heard my voice and my supplications. Because he has inclined his ear to me, I will call on him as long as I live. What shall I return to the Lord for all his bounty to me? I will lift up the cup of salvation and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people. Precious in the sight of the Lord is the death of his faithful ones. O Lord, I am your servant, the child of your serving girl. You have loosed my bonds. I will offer you a thanksgiving sacrifice and call on the name of the Lord. I will pay my vows to the Lord in the presence of all his people, in the courts of the house of the Lord, in your midst, O Jerusalem. Praise the Lord.
The epistle reading is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 5, beginning at verse 1. Therefore, since we are justified by faith, we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ, through whom we have obtained access to this grace in which we stand. And we boast in our hope of sharing the glory of God. And not only that, but we also boast in our sufferings, knowing that suffering produces endurance, and endurance produces character, and character produces hope, and hope does not disappoint us, because God's love has been poured into our hearts through the Holy Spirit that has been given to us. For while we were still weak, at the right time, Christ died for the ungodly. Indeed, rarely will anyone die for a righteous person, though perhaps for a good person, someone might actually dare to die. But God proves his love for us in that while we were still sinners, Christ died for us. The gospel reading begins at the 9th chapter and 35th verse of the Gospel of Matthew. Then Jesus went about all the cities and villages, teaching in their synagogues, and proclaiming the good news of the kingdom, and curing every disease and every sickness. When he saw the crowds, he had compassion for them, because they were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. Then he said to his disciples, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, ask the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into his harvest." Then Jesus summoned his 12 disciples and gave them authority over unclean spirits to cast them out and to cure every disease and every sickness. These are the names of the 12 apostles. First, Simon, also known as Peter, and his brother Andrew. James, son of Zebedee, and his brother John. Philip and Bartholomew. Thomas and Matthew, the tax collector. James, son of Alphaeus and Thaddeus. Simon the Canaanean, and Judas Iscariot, the one who betrayed him. These 12 Jesus sent out with the following instructions: "Go nowhere among the Gentiles and enter no town of the Samaritans, but go rather to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. As you go, proclaim the good news: the kingdom of heaven has come near. Cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. You receive without payment, give without payment. Take no gold or silver or copper in your belts, no bag for your journey, or two tunics, or sandals, or a staff, for laborers deserve their food. Whatever town or village you enter, find out who in it is worthy, and stay there until you leave. As you enter the house, greet it. If the house is worthy, let your peace come upon it. But if it is not worthy, let your peace return to you. If anyone will not welcome you or listen to your words, shake off the dust from your feet as you leave that house or town. Truly I tell you, it will be more tolerable for the land of Sodom and Gomorrah on the day of judgment than for that town. See, I am sending you out like sheep in the midst of wolves. So be wise as serpents and innocent as doves." The church in which I was raised had what we used to call mission work in 3 locations overseas: Japan, Hong Kong, and the South American nation of Colombia. In many years, in my growing up years, in the month of June here, it would not be unusual for one of the American-born ministers who labored in those parts of the Lord's vineyard to be the guest preacher at our church. And sometimes one of the native-born people of Japan or Hong Kong or Colombia, who now had grown into the work of ministry and been ordained and preached in his home country, people like that would be the guest preachers at our church. Now, someone who loved the security of home, I remember as a lad being amazed that these missionary preachers who grew up in the United States, most of them here in the South, would leave all the comforts of America to go across the vast Pacific Ocean and work for Jesus over there. And even though Japan and Hong Kong were becoming more prosperous places by this point, and there was not great financial privation, still, you were such a long way from home. And for those who were in mission in Colombia and South America, though nearer the U.S. geographically, that country was quite poor at the time, and the violence that was occasioned by the drug cartel was already on the increase. So these ministers, the American-born and the native-born in what we call the mission field, would be coming to the United States about this time of year, because that was when the annual General Assembly met. And they would attend the General Assembly, see their friends throughout the church, perhaps preach or speak there and keep up with things going on throughout the denomination. Or some of the missionaries might be on a 3 or 6 month break called a furlough. And when during that time they would come and visit churches, spread the word about their mission work and encourage our support of them in prayer and in financial commitment to the church-wide mission budget that supported their ministries. And they also got some well-deserved rest and recreation. I heard the story, probably apocryphal, of another church-going lad, something like myself, about the same age, 9 or 10 years old, who was asked in Sunday school one day what he wanted to be when he grew up and replied, a missionary on furlough. Well, today we began what I call the less busy half of the Christian year. For the past 6 months, we have been in the busy half of the liturgical year, the seasons in which the church marks the life of Christ. And so we've been through Advent, Christmas, Epiphany, Lent, culminating in Holy Week, Easter, Pentecost, and last Sunday, Trinity Sunday. Of course, it's been a very unusual busy half of the Christian year since we suspended in-person worship beginning March 22nd, the fourth Sunday in Lent. But we trust that through this online connection of worship, we have kept the faith with the unfolding story of Jesus' suffering, death, resurrection, and ascension, the coming of the Holy Spirit, and then Trinity Sunday last week, the kind of ribbon that ties all that together, as we have known God as Father, Son, and Holy Spirit through the incarnation in Christ. And now for the coming 5+ months until Advent arrives again, we are in a season called Ordinary Time, or as our organist in Nashville and I used to call today, Plain Vanilla Sunday. Kind of back to the ordinary thing, the green color. And having celebrated Jesus' suffering, death, and resurrection, we now turn to the events of his earthly ministry. These are intended for our ongoing instruction in the faith and our spiritual benefit. And so we'll be reading semi-continuously from Matthew's Gospel, following the course of Jesus' earthly ministry, listening to some of his parables, recalling some of his miracles of healing and miracles of provision, and his encounters with people along the way. And so today, in Matthew chapters 9 and 10, Jesus is sending out his disciples into the first mission field, which, he says, so far at that point, is confined to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. For now, Jesus is not sending them to Samaritans, not sending them to Gentiles. He's just to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. Now, according to the figures I found on the ever-reliable internet, the population of the Roman Empire in the early first century was about 55 million people. And the population of the whole world was about 250 million people. At the time of today's reading, just a handful of people could be called Christians, although even that's sort of an anachronism. They don't know Jesus yet as the Christ. They are followers of Jesus. They are the Jesus movement, you might call it. These 12 named disciples in today's lesson, a few women, some of whom are mentioned by name, some unnamed, perhaps members of the families of these named or unnamed disciples and women, and the occasional person that Jesus would meet who felt led also to follow, to become part of the group. And of course, there were the crowds who heard Jesus gladly, But it does not appear that many of them stuck around. They heard him, and perhaps they were spiritually refreshed, but they kept going with their own lives. And so these few dozen people were the first to believe that Jesus was someone that you ought to follow. These first followers did not even yet have the vocabulary to say all that Jesus would come to mean to them. But for now, he is their rabbi. He is their teacher. So just imagine for a moment the whole Jesus movement being no larger than our congregation. Imagine that you could fit all the followers of Jesus in our sanctuary here. And there's this rabbi called Jesus who has appeared on the scene, and no more than 100 people at this point who think he's something special. And yet here we are, a third of the world away, 2,000 years later, and like those first 100 people or so, we're following Jesus, or we're trying to. And Sunday has come to mean the time when these followers of Jesus gather together. We worship God. We sing praises. We pray. We read scripture. We have a reflection on the scripture called a sermon. We give. This God made known to us in Jesus Christ, even if we're participating virtually right now, online, we say that we are Jesus people. We are the Jesus movement now. We are Christians. We live in a world so unlike so much of that in Jesus' day. Our transportation, our communication, 1,000 other things that we have better than any Caesar had in the first century. And yet, in our troubled relationships, in our crises of the soul, and in the sheer burden that the human condition sometimes is for all of us, all that drives us to call on Jesus. Call on Jesus. He is wiser than our contemporary sages and our contemporary would-be saviors. He is our true contemporary. He is our eternal contemporary. Years ago, one of the educational programs in the Presbyterian family was called InReach Outreach. It was grounded in the conviction and the experience that we have to reach into our own hearts, where Jesus' word is taking root and growing, in order to have anything to offer as outreach in Jesus' name. Now, some Christians get impatient with the church's worship and prayer and study. They want to be doing something out there to help somebody in Jesus' name. But InReach reminds us, we'll look at the example of Jesus himself, how much time he spent in prayer, and how much time he spent teaching his followers what they needed to know. So it's disciples who listen to Jesus and who commune with God through Christ in prayer and worship, who learn what to do in Jesus' name. But the Christians who only want to spend time nourishing their own inner life, even to the point of a kind of obsessive preoccupation with every moment's feeling, emotion, and hurt, Jesus says, reach out. And when we get outside ourselves and think of others, when we notice and care for those whose circumstances are certainly harder than our own, then we begin to know something of the compassion that Jesus had for those who, as today's reading put it, were harassed and helpless, like sheep without a shepherd. So what are our hearts feeling right now? Do our hearts go out to people in need? People who are ill? People who are lonely? To those who are suffering from injustice in our society? Perhaps you hear Jesus calling you to tend to the wounds of individuals you know. Perhaps you hear Jesus calling you to work for social justice. Perhaps you hear Jesus calling you to do both. The mission Jesus gives the disciples here in today's lesson is wide-ranging. Proclaim the good news, cure the sick, raise the dead, cleanse the lepers, cast out demons. And with what I hope is a faithful exegesis of those phrases, we see what one preacher I read called the original recipe of Jesus' mission, and it's a full plate. We proclaim the good news when we read Scripture, apply it to our lives, and share its fruit with others. We cure the sick when we bring any help or solace to those who are weighed down by diseases of body or mind. We raise the dead when we are agents of Christ's hope, even in desperate circumstances. We cleanse lepers when we welcome into our midst those who may feel ostracized by their families or the society. And we cast out demons when we renounce and help others renounce the destructive forces that are loose in the world today, the hatred and the violence which are stealing from others and from ourselves the joy and the beauty that we ought to have by right of God being our creator and sustainer, Jesus being our friend and redeemer, the Holy Spirit being our comfort and our peace. So whether your mission field is halfway around the globe, right next door, or within your own home, Jesus calls, commissions, sends us to proclaim his unfailing love.
Thank you.
believe in God, the Father Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, and in Jesus Christ, his only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Ghost, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, dead, and buried. He descended into hell. The third day he rose again from the dead. He ascended into heaven and sitteth on the right hand of God the Father Almighty. From thence he shall come to judge the quick and the dead. I believe in the Holy Ghost, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen. Stars, the planet on which we live, and in the fullness of time, the human race, with minds to know you, hearts to love you, and hands to serve you. In the call to Abraham and Sarah, of descendants numerous as the stars and as the grains of sand, we find our place in your covenant family. In the electing grace by which you call us to faith in you, confirm us in our trust, and shape our lives so that we live in the joy of your presence as we seek your will and follow where you would lead us. Renew within us in these troubled days a love for your creation and for the human family you have made. Break our old habits of fear, suspicion, and hate, and let the compassion of Jesus fill us to overflowing. That we may hear the pain of sisters and brothers who suffer injustice. Help each of us to find our place and to find our voice in being instruments of your peace and ambassadors of your love. Guide the leaders of communities across our nation and lead us to the fair city whose builder you are. We pray now silently in intercession for those in need, those on our prayer list, and beyond. And so, gracious God, with thankful hearts for the example of your saints who have gone before us, those who have spread the good news of Christ's love throughout the world and into our hearts, we are grateful for their witness and their faithfulness. May the offering we present be an expression of our trust in you for now and for the days to come. And may the offering we give go forth with your blessing, spread the good news of Christ's love and our hope in him, who taught us to pray together: Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us, an offering and sacrifice to God. Let us with gladness present the offerings of our life and labor to the Lord.
Thank you.
grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you now, henceforth, and evermore.